Basically, a crime has been committed against God by our sin, and there must be punishment for that crime. It's not so much that God's honor was offended as that his righteous law, you know, his justice was broken, and we have to do something to pay for that. Well, we're not sufficient to pay for it ourselves, and so Jesus stepped in and paid it for us. That's the doctrine or the theory of penal substitution for salvation, that Christ takes the penalty, there's the penal part, penalty, of people's sin as their substitute and thus saving us from God's wrath, which is righteously deserving, we're deserving of because of our sin. Carolyn, did you have something?
Yeah, maybe it's just that these aren't the full thing, but it looks like number four doesn't have anything to do about with faith in Jesus. It's like everybody is saved because he did that, but is that not...
Anselm Wadada proposed a universalism.
Okay.
There was. I guess I don't know enough beyond this to be able to tell you where Anselm went with it. It wasn't a universalist.
Okay.
Universalist is somebody who thinks everybody gets saved. Jesus says Jesus' atonement was sufficient that everybody, you know, everybody gets a car, everybody gets a car.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all get saved in the end. Anselm would not have proposed that. He would have still said that it requires an act of faith on our part. I'm pretty sure from what I know of Anselm. But that the difference really was that because by the time the Reformers did this, okay, this is 1100, this is almost 1600. So the world had changed back by then. So the idea of presenting God as a feudal lord that we as his serfs are responsible to try to make up for some dishonor we did him didn't make sense anymore in the 15th century. And so the Reformers took that basic idea that Christ paid the price for our sin because something had to be done because of our sinfulness before God. And they put it in much more of a legal kind of setting. A crime has been committed against God, and punishment is deserving for that crime, but Jesus paid, you know, Jesus accepted the punishment for it. Okay, you see that? That make sense? Now, that is the basis of modern ideas of substitutionary atonement. There is more, I mean, back to what you were saying, Carolyn, there is much more in the penal substitution, the Reformers' view, of a focus on people having to have faith in order to receive the gift of the salvation. I think Anselm had some of that, but the Reformers, that was a huge thing. After all, what was Martin Luther, the first Reformer, or the first leader of the Reformation? There were Reformers before Martin Luther, actually, Zwingli and others. But his big thing was that, you know, by grace you're saved through faith, that Ephesians 2 passage. That it is, you know, it does require that we have faith in what has been provided to us freely. That grace is free, but it's not cheap. You know, we do have to have some faith in it. But now we get into the question. Well, we will get into the question. I want to talk about Catholicism for a minute, what the Catholic view is. But the real question of, well, how do we access this? If Jesus paid the price for us, we're going to get into how do we access, how do we acquire, how do we take advantage of that price that has been paid for us? And there's where you get into free will and predestination and Calvin and Arminius and all those things you guys are going to be mad about here in about half an hour. So we'll talk about that. But let's talk for a minute about the Catholic and the Eastern Christian view. I say Eastern Christian, you can't really say Eastern Orthodox, because there's also an Oriental Orthodox Church. There are other kind of views. They're similar, but they actually are different movements. So we talk about Eastern Christianity and Western Christianity. Western Christianity being Roman Catholicism and Protestantism that came out of it. Okay, but there's a lot of, you know, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church and the Armenian Orthodox Church are very different than the Russian Orthodox Church and the Greek Orthodox Church. They are Greek, and they have some similar basis, very much like Roman Catholicism and Protestantism does, but they really are different. So that's why we talk about Eastern Christianity, and I won't, unless I make a mistake, I won't say Eastern Orthodoxy, because it's bigger than that. Okay? And next term, take the class on church history, which will be from Jesus until the just before the Reformation, and we'll talk about the Great Schism and the 1100s and how the church split and all that kind of stuff. Okay, now, the crucial difference between Catholic and Protestant understanding salvation is that unlike Protestantism, Catholicism believes that after the fall, humanity did not become totally corrupt. Earlier I talked about total depravity, that all of me is fallen to original sin. There's no part of me, there's nothing good about me. All of me needs to be saved. Well, the Catholic viewpoint is not that radical. It's not that dramatic. The Catholic viewpoint would say that that humanity was not totally corrupt, but rather was simply wounded by sin. Not destroyed in terms of our righteousness by sin, but simply wounded by sin, and that we stand in need of salvation from God that comes through Jesus Christ, who guides us into the grace that's needed to save us and sustain us. Now, a huge difference here is that the Catholic Church believes that salvation was given by Christ to the church to administer. That it is the church that is necessary in the process of providing grace. That grace literally was given to the church to distribute as the church, that is the Roman Catholic Church, determines appropriate. And that salvation requires that you participate in the sacraments, which are the means by which grace is distributed in the Catholic Church. Baptism first is necessary beyond just faith. You can have the same amount of faith and not be baptized, or be baptized, not being baptized and having faith, you're not saved. Being baptized and having faith, you're saved. That's Catholic doctrine. And beyond that, any other acts that you commit that are considered mortal sins, and there are lists of venial sins, which are not big deals, you still need to ask forgiveness, but you're not going to be damned for it, or a mortal sin, if you commit a mortal sin, then you lose your salvation, even if you have faith. You can't then just ask for forgiveness. You have to go back to the church, and through sacraments of reconciliation, you then can be forgiven of it and be saved. So salvation is a mechanism that is controlled by the church in the Catholic viewpoint. That grace is administered by the church. There even used to be, and to be quite honest, I don't know if this is still literally a doctrine of the church, or if they just sort of, it still is and they don't mention it anymore, or they actually have done away with it, but it used to be the idea that the church maintained a bank of grace. That when a saint of God died, they had more grace than they needed for salvation. All of the extra they had became the property of the church. And the church then could distribute that as they needed to and wanted to. This was what the sale of indulgences was about back in Luther's time. One of the things that he got most upset about is if you gave a gift of money, then the person for whom you wanted to, you know, that you bequeathed that grace to, they would receive extra grace to be released from purgatory or something else. The guy who Luther had so much trouble with, Tetzel was his name, I think?
John Tetzel.
Yeah. He had a jingle. Because he was collecting money and distributing these indulgences, these sort of quantities of grace that the church had to give away. He said, and as soon as the coin in the coffer rings, the soul from out of purgatory springs. That was part of their doctrine of grace and salvation, and it's a very different understanding. Now, the Council of Trent was the council that met in the Counter-Reformation. That is, after the Reformation started, and was really, really gaining ground, the Catholic Church got together in a council of the Catholic Church, which was the Council of Trent, in order specifically to address the issues of how do we fight back against the Reformation. And a lot of doctrinal things came out of that, but two of the statements that came out of the Council of Trent were, first, if anyone says that the sinner is justified by faith alone, meaning that nothing else is required to cooperate in order to obtain the grace of justification, let him be anathema. That means cursed. That means excommunicated. So they very clearly said, if you believe that you're justified by faith alone and don't require the church, you're excommunicated, you're anathema. Another quote, if anyone saith that the sacraments of the new law being the Catholic law of love as they interpreted it, if anyone saith that the sacraments of the new law are not necessary unto salvation but superfluous, and that without them or without the desire thereof, men obtain of God through faith alone the grace of justification, though all the sacraments are not indeed necessary for every individual, that let them be anathema. In other words, again, not just by faith, if you believe, not just that by faith alone you're saved, that's all that's necessary, the grace of God is applied for salvation. If you deny the necessity of the sacraments in becoming saved, then you are anathema, excommunicated. All right? So, in Catholicism, Christ provides the church with the church, notice, provides the church with the fullness of the means of salvation which he has willed, correct and complete confession of faith, full sacramental life, participating in the sacraments, and the ordained ministry of apostolic succession, that the priests, by apostolic succession, have the authority to apply grace to your life. Apart from that, it is not available to you. Okay? Very different idea than ours. Eastern Christianity, again, that's Eastern Orthodoxy, Oriental Orthodoxy, the churches in the East, the Greek-oriented churches, were not so much influenced by Augustine, who was sort of the basis of what Anselm said and a lot of others. They generally viewed salvation less in terms of legalistic ideas, like this one, the idea that a law has been broken, or the law of God has been broken, and a penalty has to be paid. They didn't see it as much in legalistic terms of grace and punishment. Eastern Christianity saw it much more along the lines of terms of medical illness. That instead of legally that grace is available in lieu of punishment, that healing is available in lieu of sickness. That sin, the need for salvation, was identified more as a sickness. There's much more of a view of salvation along the lines of what's called a theosis, that is a seeking to become holy or to draw closer to God. Now, if that sounds familiar, become more holy, draw closer to God. Remember that number one was never really viewed as much in the West as it was in the East. This was early church, and remember where the early church was. It was mostly Palestine, North Africa, the Middle East, Syria, and Asia Minor, Turkey. And so these kinds of ideas are fairly consistent. They're not exactly the same as these old ideas, but some of them, all three of these, were much more Eastern ideas, and they versions of them are still kind of maintained today. All right? Any question about any of those different ideas about how we get saved, those five theories? And this one, penal substitution, with varying degrees within Protestantism that we're going to talk about later, is the doctrine we hold today. That our sin has committed, in effect, a violation against God and His holiness and His righteousness, and that there's a price that has to be paid for that. We are insufficient on our own to pay that price. We're not able to. And God, in His love, chose to pay the price for us. In fact, I had a quote here, and I didn't read it. Let me see if I can find that real quick. It was from Anselm. Well, I don't see it right now. Anyway, it had to do with the fact that God in His righteousness demanded payment, but God in His love did not require that payment of us, but rather provided it Himself. So He's a righteous, and He's also a merciful God. And the idea of Jesus paying the price for us reflects that He is a righteous God who couldn't just say, whatever. You know, righteousness demanded payment for the sin. And yet, as a holy, loving, and merciful God, He provided that payment Himself rather than expecting it of us because we were not sufficient to it. Okay? Questions about that? Michael?
Thinking back on C.S. Lewis's writings, and I'm seeing a lot of three and four, and not so much one, two, and five. Is that the ransom idea?
Well, he uses the term ransom, yes. But I don't think he means ransom in the same way that this was. It's not that Jesus... Satan tried to take Jesus' soul and for whatever reason failed, and in the process he lost control of everything. That's what that ransom theory kind of is. Lewis, like in the Space Trilogy, the main character in the Space Trilogy is named Ransom. And the idea is that a ransom had to be paid, a price had to be paid to compensate for the sin that had been committed, the evil that had been done. That's actually, even though the words may sound wrong, that's actually more penal substitution than it is anything else. That we had violated the righteousness of God, and a ransom or a price had to be paid, and that it was Jesus who paid that price, and He was the ransom. It doesn't involve arm wrestling with Satan, which is what the old, which is what this one is. The idea, the belief that Satan had power over people's souls in the afterlife, but Christ rescued them from that power, that's not Lewis. Lewis would say, Jesus was the perfect ransom for our sake because He paid the price for us. Because the price had to be paid because of our sinfulness. And that's much more penal substitution. Okay, that He filled in for us. All right, let's talk about Protestantism for a minute and what we believe in a little more detail. The Protestant Reformation was based upon the five great sole. We sometimes only talk about the first three, but there really were five. That is the five great soles or solo statements of the Reformation were first solo gratia, by grace alone. Then sola fide, by faith alone. Sola scriptura, by scripture alone. Solus Christus, through Christ alone. And soli Deo gloria, gloria to God alone. Now, the reason these were the cries of the Protestants is because the whole Catholic Church that Luther and then those after him were confronting was built upon the idea that Christians somehow merit God's grace by performing rituals or good works or ascetic acts or meditation or something else, and that grace by itself was not sufficient. That you had to do something, you had to do works. And so, based upon the New Testament, Romans, Ephesians 2 that I quoted earlier, and various other places, Luther first, and then others after him, including John Calvin, the founder of Reformation theology, they said, no, Scripture says you don't have to do those works. You don't have to go to the church and take the sacraments in order to receive grace. That grace is available to you simply as a gift of God. By grace you're saved through faith, not of your works. It is a gift of God, not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So it's grace only, faith only. Our authority for that is Scripture only, because remember, the Catholic Church maintains that there maintained and still maintains that there are two equal sources of authority in the Christian faith. There is Scripture, but there is also the magisterium of the Church. The Church itself has authority. So I've heard so many Protestants say, where does the Catholic Church get this stuff about purgatory and about, you know, the Mary being born sinless and all that kind of, well, it's because at various times the authorities of the Catholic Church have said God has given them this understanding, and that has equal weight in the Catholic Church with Scripture. And so that's where they get those doctrines, and you can argue from Scripture, you know, if there are places where Scripture says, this says that can't be true, that's one thing. But if you just say it's not in here, they go, well, that's okay. God gave it to us through the Church. So you have to understand that, to understand these differences, and to understand what was happening in the Reformation. When they said sola scriptura, they said, no, the Church doesn't have equal authority. Scripture alone has authority to determine our faith. And it tells us, all you need is grace, received by faith. And the whole purpose is not that the Church be built up or anything else. It is Christ alone. We are saved through Christ alone, not because the Church tells us we are, because the Church gave us sacraments, or the Church has priests who are apostolically succeeded, you know, down from, by laying on of hands from Peter, or anything else. It is through Christ alone we are saved, and it is to the glory of God alone, not to anybody or any institution. Those are the five great soles, which sort of summarize what the principles were that the Reformation was built on, and therefore that the Protestant faith is built on. Does that make sense? So we understood, Protestants understood, God saves solely by grace, and that works are not necessary for salvation, but that works should then follow as a necessary consequence of us being saved by grace. Again, this is the book of Acts. Faith without works is dead. You are not saved by works. You were saved by grace that you receive in faith, but if you really mean it, then your life is going to change, and it's going to be demonstrated in terms of how you live. There also was, some people disagreed with that, even in the Reformation, and they said that salvation was accomplished by faith alone, but that you had to, there were some works involved in getting there. You know, you had to do penance, or you had to do something else, even when Protestantism started. And then there are others who would say that you're saved by grace, received by faith, but you can lose all of that if you don't live right. Okay, you still have work to do. And if you don't do it, you lose the salvation you got by grace through faith. So there still were different ideas or understandings of what the atonement was. But the fundamental idea was that human beings still, we owe to God some debt we can't pay. Christ pays it on our behalf. Thus God remains both perfectly just, that is, insisting upon the penalty being paid, and imperfectly loving by paying the penalty himself. That's the foundation of the Christian faith according to the Protestant belief, all right? But we run into a difficulty in terms of how do we access that? How do we apply that to our lives? How do we get that salvation? What part do we have in it? I guess that's a good way to say that. William Plaicher has said, debates about how Christ saves us, not that he does, but how he does, have tended to divide Protestants into conservatives who defend some form of substitutionary atonement theory, which is what that penalty, or the penal substitution was, and liberals who were more apt to accept a kind of moral influence theory. Remember that moral development idea? But there are questions about how we access this salvation. For instance, is salvation accomplished by grace through faith alone, without any reference to any works of any kind? Is it? If you believe that's true, what about the work of deciding for and choosing Christ? If I am victim of total depravity, my will is broken, my soul is lost, my mind is bent, my body is failing, what part of me is sufficient for me to recognize and desire and claim faith in Christ? Isn't that a kind of work? Maybe just mental work or spiritual work, but it's something where, if you mean by work something you have to do, then does that mean that there is a work, there is something you have to do in order for you to be saved?
I have heard that debated.
Oh, you will have heard it debated. It is the biggest debate in Protestantism for the last 600 years. Well, 500 years. This issue is the one we're going to talk about right now. Let me give you a couple of definitions as the foundation for that. Well, first, let's take a break. And we're going to come back and we're going to let John Calvin in.
Is this going to become a matter of semantics?
No. We'll get
about work.
Well, it's. I don't think it is. I mean, somebody could say that it's a matter of semantics, but I don't think it is. Okay. Alberta?
Well, maybe that answers the question, because faith is not really work. Like faith, you just believe, but mm-hmm. it is something that you do.
Right.
So,
and if work is something you do, and Scripture says it's not anything you do, how does that work?
You believe.
So to speak.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Well, Rod, I want to get into this real quick. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say that this helps with understanding James better, and I also pick up that our readings for Friday and things like that, those two books help a lot to explain how we should develop now.
Okay, and that's the spiritual disciplines class.
Yeah.
Okay, let's talk about what is required for us to receive salvation. And some of what I'm going to tell you in the next 45 minutes, your hour even, because we're going to go longer today, you're not going to agree with, you may not even like, but be open to the fact that people, righteous people of God, have and still do disagree on this because it's not easy. I think that the opinion that many, many people have about this, that they think is just, oh, of course, it's because they've never really thought about all the consequences of the of course. There are some pretty serious questions in here. They are questions that we are not going to know all the answers to until we are in the presence of God. Nor are the answers to some of these questions necessary for our own salvation. We have to have some humility about this, which is the most rare of all things amongst people who are theologians or are serious about theological thought. Okay, so let me get us started on this. Free will, I want to give you three definitions. Free will is the belief that we have the freedom to make choices that are not determined by prior causes or by divine intervention. Now, in the notes for this class, the study notes, I ask, what is the meaning of free will in the context of salvation, which is a slightly different thing. Let me read that to you so that you know. In the context of salvation, free will means the belief that all people have the complete freedom to choose or to not choose reconciliation to God that is offered by the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ. You pick. Either be saved or not be saved. It's your choice. That's what free will means. Mm-hmm. Now, there are very strong reasons to believe that that's not accurate. Mm-hmm. that's at least that's not how it works.
No.
Let's keep going. Now again, some of you are going, no, what? You're wrong! You haven't even heard the rest of it yet. A second definition, sovereign predestination. Sovereign predestination, or just predestination you might call it, is the belief that all events are willed by God. Applied to soteriology or to salvation, the belief that God saves those whom he chooses, the elect, apart from human action or decision. Some of that is based upon the idea that if it's you having to choose it, how can you choose the right if you suffer from total depravity, unless God does something? Or isn't the very act of making a decision about something a kind of work, because it's something you do, and that's the definition of a work? Now, a third definition, which will come into things as we talk, is the idea of prevenient grace. Prevenient grace is the idea that there's a divine grace that precedes human decisions, and which, I took out something from my notes, and which allows people to accept or reject the salvation offered in Jesus Christ. That maybe the way it works is that there is a special kind of grace, prevenient grace, which is available to all of us, which is by itself sufficient to allow us to make a decision without it being a work of our broken or our totally depraved selves. Okay, that's one of the ideas that's come up. Now I want to talk about that as we get into it. First, I want to talk about what predestination is. Christians understand the doctrine of predestination as an issue with regard to God's work of salvation in the world. Again, the question is, we've agreed that salvation is something that is provided to us by the atoning sacrifice of Christ to pay the penalty we could not pay for our own sin. We understand that. Well, how do we get? Where do I go to be able to access this? So, the doctrine of predestination, let me give you a little bit of background history on this. The earliest church fathers, first three centuries, consistently focused on the freedom of human choice. Now, one of the reasons for that, almost completely dominant in the first three centuries, is because there were a number of Christian or pseudo-Christian heresies in the first two and three centuries, which had to do with a complete lack of free will. Cynicism was a philosophy that got applied to the Christian faith. Gnosticism, this idea that, you know, it's special knowledge and there's a lack of will involved in that. Manichaeism was a major threat in terms of a heresy against the early church. And Augustine of Hippo, who himself had been a Manichaean before he became Christian, or before he became an Orthodox Christian. Augustine of Hippo, in the 400s, one of the greatest, not only theologians, but philosophers in human history. He dealt with this issue, especially with regard to being in opposition to the Manichaean doctrines where human beings have no control over anything. Augustine marked the beginning of a place where Christian thought began to question whether or not humanity really has free will with respect to salvation, whether we can choose our salvation, or whether salvation begins by an initial act of God in the life of every person. Election. Now, the idea of prevenient grace came along later. The idea that, well, maybe it's not election, meaning God chooses us for salvation. Since we can't do it ourselves, God, Augustine said, God acted to save us before we could do anything. The idea of prevenient grace, that maybe there's some special kind of grace that comes in there that allows us to be saved because we are totally depraved. All right? Now, still in the midst of that, Augustine still argued for free will. But that human will was so distorted that we were unable to really do anything productive with it. Okay, there are three really different ways of dealing with the idea of election. Election means those who are saved, okay, and how you get to be one of the saved. With human will, and whether it's free or not, with justification, which is another way of saying getting saved, with conversion from being unsaved to being saved, what's the process? And then, are you, once you're saved, are you always saved? There's another controversy, which we'll talk about. There are three major views within the Christian faith. They're not all lime green, but these are. Here I've looked at, on the left-hand column, the topic, human will, election, justification, conversion, and then preservation and apostasy, meaning staying saved versus departing from the faith because of unfaith. The left-hand column is John Calvin, or Calvinism. And I need to draw a distinction here. Calvinism, most people who disagree with hyper-Calvinism, you know, and I'll talk about the 5 points of Calvinism in a minute, mostly your people who react against that are reacting against the people who came after Calvin. Calvin, and they're called the hyper-Calvinists. They're the ones that came up with the 5 points of Calvinism. John Calvin didn't. These are our interpretations of Calvin. Calvin was much more modest about the whole thing and recognized that there are limitations to how far we can carry stuff. The hyper-Calvinists that came later declared that this is all, you know, absolutely clear, and they nailed it against the wall and said, if you don't agree, you're damned to hell. Okay, that wasn't Calvin. And I'll give you some comments later from Calvin. But Calvin did look at Scripture, and I'm going to give you some Scripture verses. He looked at Scripture and said, with regard to human will, it appeared to him human beings suffered from total depravity, which means we were without free will permanently due to divine sovereignty. We are completely, totally sinful. We cannot, our will is so broken, we are unable to choose things of God. And so therefore, God in His sovereignty chooses for us. Okay? That comes into the doctrine of election. Calvin identified unconditional election to salvation for those with those outside the elect foreordained to damnation, what's called double predestination. Calvin said, those who are saved are elected, and I'll give you the scripture verses shortly, elected to be saved by God, because we can't get ourselves there. We can't even make the choice. And Calvin draws the completely reasonable conclusion that if in all of humanity God has chosen these and not chosen these, He chose these to salvation, then apparently those are chosen to damnation. There's a logical consequence there that you can't really argue against. Now, Luther, who's the one in the middle, believed in unconditional predestination to salvation for the elect, but he would not go the next step and say those who are not selected or elected for salvation are elected for damnation. I believe it's because Luther wasn't willing to go there, because he couldn't deal with the consequences of it. Calvin was a brilliant guy. He was a lawyer, and he said the logic takes us there. If we believe that God, as Luther agreed, unconditionally elects certain people to salvation, de facto, as a result of that, those he didn't elect to salvation must be elected to damnation. I'm not asking you to agree. I'm just telling you, you need to understand what the differences are. Ron?
Calvin's background helped him there too, because being a lawyer, you're always looking for one or the other.
Well, yeah, I wouldn't blame this on him being a lawyer. I think his theology is sound, you know. But he was a rigorous thinker, more so than most other theologians. You know, Calvin was a rigorous thinker, and when he found something in Scripture, he didn't dodge it, and he was willing to draw the conclusions based upon. Again, do you understand what I'm saying? Is if as Luther agreed, if God selects certain people unconditionally to be saved, then if He doesn't select these other people, then they must be chosen for damnation. There's a logical consequence there that Calvin was willing to admit, Luther wasn't. Again, you don't have to agree with it, and we're going to get into some details about this. Then the issue of justification. Well, I should go across. So, you know, human will, you've got Calvinism, Lutheranism in the middle, and on the right is Arminianism. It is the ideas of Jacob Arminius, who was a 15th century Dutch reform. Interestingly enough, he came out of a reform tradition which Calvin had really created. You know, from Calvinism, and when Calvin was writing theology, the reform theology in Switzerland, it went to the Netherlands and became Dutch reform thought, and to Scotland, and it became the Presbyterian reform thought, from which the Presbyterian church comes. Now, so, but Arminius, Jacob Arminius, was a Dutch reform theologian in the 1600s, and he said, across total depravity, Calvin says total depravity is without free will, will permanently rely upon divine sovereignty totally. Luther said there was total depravity without free will until spiritual regeneration. Once you got saved, then you had the will to choose things. And Arminius says depravity does not prevent free will. You still have the ability to choose. And he's the one that really came up most significantly, there's a Calvinist doctrine of this too, with the idea of prevenient grace, that there's some grace that allows you to choose, even though you are depraved. Okay. Depraved meaning sinful. Election. Calvin said there's unconditional election to salvation, and that those outside the elect are foreordained to damnation, just by logical default. Luther, in election, said unconditional predestination to salvation for the elect, but he wouldn't take that next step. Arminius said there's conditional election in a view of foreseen faith or belief. In other words, that election isn't entirely determined by God, it's conditional based upon how people react to things. Now, I'll get to this in a minute. Arminius is the one that gave people the idea that, well, it isn't that God elected or predestined anybody, it's just that God could see into the future and he knew what people were going to decide. Philosophically, that's been completely blown out of the water as being irrational. Because if God knew exactly who in the future was going to decide yes or no, and he didn't do anything to change it, then again, logically, he created things in such a way that some people would choose yes and some people would choose no. So he created certain people for election and certain people for not. The idea that he could foresee it and didn't actually do it is logically it's called the paradox of free will. It's not possible, logically, for that to be true. Under justification, under Calvinism, justification is limited to those who are predestined to salvation. The total package of salvation occurred at Christ's death, at which point the decision was made about who would be elected and who wouldn't in the future. Under Lutheranism, justification is by faith alone, again completed at Christ's death, but Luther didn't take that next step in terms of how does that apply to elect and not elect. Arminius said that justification was made possible for everyone through Christ's death, but only completed through choosing faith in Jesus. Here's one where I tend to agree a little bit more with Arminius. Because justification is limited. Again, if you follow the rationality of that, it means that Christ's sacrifice on the cross was not sufficient to save everybody. It was only sufficient to save those who were elect by God the Father. I'm not willing to say that the sacrifice of Christ was not sufficient for everybody. In fact, there is such a thing, I'm going to talk about 5-point Calvinism, there is such a thing as 4-point Calvinism. People who have trouble with that one. And I think I probably count myself as one of those. Under conversion, Calvin would say that conversion is monergistic. Monergistic means one energy, that it is God alone who causes people to be converted, that we don't have any energy involved in it. Luther, and it's irresistible, meaning that God calls us and we're going to respond. We're going to say yes. The Holy Spirit will cause the people who God calls to say yes. Luther would agree with monergism through the means of grace, but he believed it was resistible. You could say no. And Calvin would say, then you were denying, if that's what God wants, and he is the one that's causing it, and you believe we have the power to say no, so we have the power to defy God? We have the power to say God can't do what he wants if he chooses to save us? And then you get Arminianism, was synergistic, is that faith is resistible. Salvation is resistible due to the common grace of free will. Then under preservation and apostasy, very simply, Calvin, and I don't completely agree here, and I'm going to explain that, believed in the perseverance of the saints, that those who were elect would always be elect. They couldn't lose their faith. Luther felt that falling away was possible, but that God gave an assurance of salvation, meaning it's possible, but it's not going to happen because God promised it wouldn't. Which, I love Martin Luther, but there's several places where Luther just sort of waffles. This is one of them. Another one is consubstantiation. That the body and blood of Christ does not really change. I mean, the bread and wine does not really change in the body and blood. It's in transubstantiation. He's right there. But then he said the presence of Christ is over, under, around, and through. Come on, Marty. What does that mean? Okay? What I think is the same thing, and others have, it's not just mine, which is transignification. That for all significance, for all purpose, for all value, it becomes the body and blood of Christ. Not literally, but significantly. In other words, when I take the body and blood of Christ, the cup and the bread, in faith, it has for me as much significance and impact and import as if it really had been converted to the body and blood of Christ. Mm. But Luther, and my apology to the Lutheritarians in our midst, you know, Luther danced around it. Well, I have to give him credit, though. He was the first one to deal with most of this stuff. And so other people had the advantage of having a little more time to think about it. Okay? So, anyway, and Arminius says that preservation is conditional, meaning saints can be unsaved. There is a possibility of final apostasy. Now, that's a huge amount of stuff. And mostly I have that chart up there so you can go back and look at it. But I want to talk about these, particularly Arminianism, that is the free will argument, and Calvinism, the idea of predestination, in a little more particular terms. Yes?
Just a question about the significance of Arminianism. I mean, are there churches that are Arminian?
Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, there are probably more Arminian churches than there are Reformed churches.
You have never heard of them before.
Oh, Baptists?
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, Congregationalists, probably Anglican. Carolin? Yeah, what's that?
Carolins and
Carolin. Yeah. Yeah. Well, Arminianism is I'm pretty sure would be more dominant than Calvinism, than the Calvinist theology.
Is there any background on him? I mean,
I'm about to talk about it.
Yeah, who was he?
I'm about to tell you. As soon as you be quiet, I'll tell you. Okay. Let me talk about Arminianism. Arminius died in the early 1600s, so most of his writing was actually in the 1500s. But like Calvin, he had people who followed him. And in 1610, they created what they called the Five Articles of Remonstrance, which I believe they did this as sort of a response to the five points of Calvinism. Tulip. You ever heard Tulip? You know, I'll give you those in a minute. But I want to start with Arminianism because it's probably more where more of you are coming from. Arminianism was a school of soteriological thought, that is, thought about salvation, within the Dutch Reformed Church. The Dutch Reformed theologian Jacob Arminius, or Jacobus Arminius, they tended to want to Latinize all their names back then. I would be Rossus Arnoldus, I guess. But, he lived from 1560 to 1609, and then the Five Points of Remonstrance were written the year after he died. Arminius based a lot of his thinking on the philosophy of a man named Luis de Molina, which was called Molinism, that attempted to reconcile the very idea of freedom, human freedom, free choice, free will, with God's omniscience. If God knows everything, so he knows who's going to be saved and who's not. Who's going to choose or not, if that's the way you want to put it. And he's all powerful, so he could change it if he wanted, but he doesn't. Then there's that paradox of free will. Does that not mean that God left it that way because he intended it to be that way? You know? Or do we think God was just clumsy about it? So, Molina had tried to create some way of understanding that really had to do with a libertarian kind of philosophy. That man's choice is not decided by God's choice, but God's choices are conditional depending upon what man chooses. It gets kind of complicated. It boiled down to the idea that God can see into the future, but he doesn't control what's in the future, which other theologians had a lot of trouble with. Well, Arminius took some of those first ideas, and he developed this idea, as he described it, as God looking down through the corridors of time to see the free choices of human beings, and choosing those who will respond in faith and love to God's love and promises revealed in Jesus, but he didn't actually do it. Arminius and Arminianism sees the choice of Christ as an impossibility apart from God's grace. And this is the part where he sort of modifies Molina's ideas. That's where he developed the idea of prevenient grace. That God gives a little bit of grace, initially, that allows us the ability to choose for him or against him, but is not sufficient for salvation. It's only when we say yes, based upon the ability that prevenient grace gives us, that we actually can accept the sacrifice of Jesus Christ as atonement and be saved. Okay. So it's almost like there's that little in-between place where prevenient grace gives us the ability to say yes or no. Okay. Now, again, Arminius would insist that God does not predetermine, but he lets us choose. But Arminius, nor anybody after him, really has been able to address the philosophical argument of the paradox of free will. That a God who can know everything and knows who will choose and who can do anything and can decide what to do about it and doesn't do anything about it, how is that not election? Okay. Arminians agree, however, with Calvin, that all people are born sinful, all people need salvation. The classical Arminians emphasize God's free grace, the prevenient grace that is available to people sufficient to let them choose, and then that a person's saving relationship with Christ is conditional upon them choosing faith in Christ, using that prevenient grace, so that a person can, can be in faith and salvation, but that a person also can decide against Jesus and lose their salvation. Now, I want to walk through the five articles of remonstrance briefly. We'll come back. The first is conditional election, which means, there's no predetermined group of people who are elect. It's dependent upon human choice. There is human choice involved, as opposed to Calvin's and even Luther's unconditional election. Some people are chosen to be saved. There is unlimited atonement, which means salvation is sufficient to save everybody if they will accept it, and so salvation is open to all. Calvin proposed limited atonement, that Christ's sacrifice was only for the people who were elect and did not apply to anybody else. That's the one I have trouble with. The third doctrine, the Articles of Remonstrance in Arminianism, is the idea of total depravity, which is complete agreement across the board on that one, that we are completely broken in whole part, not in whole, not in part, by our sin. Original sin affects all of us. There's no part of us that's good. That's why Arminius had to come up with the concept of prevenient grace in order to explain how is it if we are completely or totally depraved, completely absorbed by original sin, how are we able to come back and select Christ? He says there's a special little thing that goes on there. Fourth, Arminius maintained, and those following him maintained, total depravity and resistible grace. In other words, we are completely, totally depraved. That's point three. But that's related to resistible grace. You still have a free will to choose, and you can choose no. That's the resistible part. You can say no to the grace that's available. And then, the fifth point, the possibility of apostasy, and that is that salvation is revocable. Your salvation can be taken away, or you can lose it if you prove not worthy in some way. Okay? Do you understand what those terms mean, as I've explained them? Any question about that?
Only insofar as how many of these are supported by Scripture?
Well, I'm going to give you scripture verses for both sides.
Okay.
In fact, how about we do that right now? Scripture verses in defense of free will. And this isn't all of them, but this is a good sample. Ezekiel 18:31-32. Rid yourself of all the offenses you have committed and get a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, people of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent and live. Certainly sounds like you can make the decision, repent from your sins, and be accepted. Now, this is Old Testament law, but then you get Mark 16:15-17. He said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. Sounds like there's a choice involved there. Okay? Why else do we evangelize if it's all predecided? Romans 10:9-13. If you declare with your mouth, I quote this all the time, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As Scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame, for there is no difference between Jew and Gentile, the same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Pretty convincing. Let's look at some more. John 3:16-19. You guys know this one, but you may not. We don't usually quote the rest of it after John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. 2 Corinthians 5:15. And he died for all. This is why I have trouble with the limited atonement idea. I believe he died for everyone. The question is then how do we access that? That those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. And then 1 Timothy 2, 3 to 5. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. Sure sounds like Arminius had it right, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's a little more complicated. Okay, let's look at the 5 points of Calvinism. Now, this is beyond what Calvin said. This is what the post-Calvinist or hyper-Calvinist proposed. The basics are still there, but it's much harder and harsher and sure of itself than Calvin, I think, presented it. I had the great good fortune and blessing to study Calvin's institutes with J.I. Packer at Regent, if you know J.I. Packer, truly one of the great theologians and saints of the church of the 20th century. He's still active, still teaching, and I had an 8-person seminar on Calvin's institutes with him. And if there's one thing I came out of that class with, well, two things. One, he told me if I would learn Latin, my thinking would be clearer. And two, that Calvin, as reflected in Calvin's Institutes, which is his magnum opus, that is his great book, you know, his ultimate theology, is quite a bit different in tone, if not in content, from hyper-Calvinism that gets presented in the 5 points of Calvinism. Tulip. Let me talk about Calvin a little bit, and then I'll go through these points. First, in most Christian discussion, when you use the word predestination, people mean Calvin. Because predestination, while Calvin was not the only one, or Calvinism is not the only aspect of predestination that exists, it is the one that's best known, the one that is theologically more prominent. There's more discussion of that. So predestination actually, to many people, means John Calvin and his doctrine. Calvin himself defined predestination like this, and I quote, "It is the eternal decree of God by which he determined with himself whatever he wished to happen with regard to every man." Okay, now, Calvin's doctrine of election and predestination is based upon the absolute sovereignty of God, that God is absolutely in charge and he can do what he wants. And he chooses. He goes on, "Not all are created on equal terms, but some are preordained to eternal life, others to eternal damnation. And accordingly, as each one has been created for one or the other of these ends, we say that he has been predestined to life or to death." Now, in Calvinism, the teaching is that God's predestining decision is based upon the knowledge of his own will rather than foreknowledge. In other words, it's not God looking down the corridors of time to see what's going to happen and then, you know, and letting it go. It's that God knows what he wants. And God chooses what he wants, apart from anything that we wish to do. It is the sovereignty of God issue. Now, Calvin would maintain that he is also a loving God, and we have to hold those two things in balance. Calvin is not some morbid Puritan who believes that God is this, we are sinners in the hands of an angry God, although that was written by Jonathan Edwards, who was not an angry Puritan either. He was the greatest theologian America's ever produced. But anyway, the idea that God is all judgment and that he's angry and that he's just looking at the new people, that's not what Calvin was about. He just said God is God and he can do what he wants apart from what we think or desire. Okay, that's fundamental to his idea. He goes on to say that God continually acts with entire freedom in whatever he does in order to bring about his will to completeness in such a way that the freedom of the creature is not violated but rather established. God is not violating our will, but rather is simply establishing his will as being appropriate. I'll give you some verses in a minute so that you don't think Calvin's just making this stuff up. I think that Calvin was the most honest and rigorous interpreter of some of the passages that I'm going to give you, which is why he came to these things, even though he knew it was not going to sound good, it's not going to sound popular. It's also true that Calvin, or the appropriate, other than the hyper-Calvinists, they never tried to divide predestination in a mathematical way. You know, you're in, you're out, you two are in, you three are out. Okay? That's not the way this is supposed to be understood. It's not for the sake of deciding who's saved and who's not, even though it's been applied that way sometimes. I'm going to read you a quote from Calvin in a little bit. "Expressed sympathetically, the Calvinist doctrine is that God has mercy or withholds mercy with particular consciousness of who will be the recipients of that mercy. In effect, all of us start out condemned. The fact that God saves some and doesn't save all is not a negative. so much as it is that those that he does save is a sign purely of God's mercy and grace. There is no requirement on him to save any, and yet he does. Therefore, the particular people who are chosen out of the total number of human beings to be rescued from the enslavement to sin and fear of death are given the blessing of being able to dwell with him forever in his presence. Those that are saved are given the assurance of his gifts of faith, of the sacraments, of communion with God. We are to be blessed. So we tend to think, focus on the negative side without thinking that we're all on the negative side until God steps in and saves some of us. And then the logic tells us, because God only saved some of us, God decided that the others were not to be saved. It's hard. But there is both scriptural support and there is logic to it. By implication, however, let's be fair. The unsympathetic view of Calvinism is that if you subtract the number of elect from the total number of people, it leaves you the exact number of people who God consciously and willingly determines to pass over and to not show his mercy to, and that they will dwell forever away from his presence. And that is very hard for us to take. My sense is the majority of people who do not accept Calvinism don't accept it because they just don't like it. It offends our sensibilities. But that by itself is not enough reason for us to make decisions about what's right or wrong on points of theology. Okay? Now, let me walk you through this, and then I'm going to give you some scripture verses for where John Calvin was coming from. Total depravity is the idea of original sin, that we are completely lost and broken in ourselves. There is nothing in us that is good enough to be sufficient to cause us to will a desire for God. Secondly, there is unconditional election. That if God chooses who will be saved without influence by human decision or anything else. The third point, which is the one I have a little trouble with, is limited atonement. The idea that Jesus' sacrifice on the cross was only efficacious or sufficient for those people who were part of the elect. Those who are not the elect has no impact on them. I am inclined theologically to believe, and not just because I want to, that the sacrifice of Christ was sufficient for all people, and yet only some were elect. I'm getting into some theological fine points there, but I'm not going to take the next 16 hours to talk about it, okay? Then irresistible grace, the idea that when God calls, you answer. What's called an effectual calling. Those who are called by God, the Holy Spirit brings them over into the body of the elect, and you don't say no to it. And then the perseverance of the saints. Calvin would say that salvation was irrevocable. If you were one of the elect, then you were one of the elect and you are saved. I think that's true to a point. And I'm going to talk about that at the very end. You know, are you once saved, always saved? I say yes and no. Let me give you some scripture. And I'll tell you why. I'm going to leave it there. I'll come back to that. Let me give you some verses. In defense of sovereign predestination. Jeremiah 1:5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. Philippians 2:12-13, therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. God who acts in you in order to fulfill his good purpose. The idea being that you work out your salvation with fear and trembling, meaning you obey the book of James. You know, you do the right thing. You live the kind of life you should because God has already willed and acted in you to fulfill his purpose. And Mark 4:10-12. When he was alone, the 12 and the others around him asked him about the parables. He told them, the secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you. But to those who are on the outside, everything is said in parables, so that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving, ever hearing but never understanding, otherwise they might turn and be forgiven.
I have real trouble with that.
Okay.
Why does God...
Well, that's what we're saying. That suggests that God has chosen some people to understand and other people to not understand, and he's specific about it.
Well, all through the Bible it says he closed their ears or something. Or
ding, 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 ding. Yeah. Suzanne?
It's also the Book of Life.
What's that? The Book of Life. There are names written in the Book of Life. Now, Arminius would have said, well, yeah, but your name gets written in there when you say yes. Yeah. But the suggestion is the Book of Life has probably existed forever. Let me keep going with some other verses. We'll come back. Because Calvin's got a you know, a pretty strong witness here. Ephesians 1, 3 to 6. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. Now, okay, I'll keep going. Romans 8, 28 to 30. For we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Again, we always quote that part, but we don't continue. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. It sure sounds like this happened before we had a chance to make a decision about it. Okay, keep going. 1 Corinthians 2, 7 and 8. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. Acts 13, 48. When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord, and all who were appointed for eternal life believed. Ephesians 2, 8 to 10. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves. Quoted this earlier. It is a gift of God, not of works, so that no one can boast. And again, Calvinism would say that the ability to choose and the act of choosing is a kind of work. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Before now, before us. But the real kicker, the one that I'm sure has Arminius rolling over in his grave, you know, at 3:12 and 6 or whatever, is this one. Romans 9, 14 to 25. You're going to have trouble seeing that, but I'll read it to you. What then, well, this is right after Paul quotes the Old Testament where it says, Jacob I have loved and Esau I have hated.
Yeah.
That passage? It goes on. Paul says, what then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. It does not therefore depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. For Scripture says to Pharaoh, I raised you up for this very purpose, that I might display my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. Therefore, God has mercy on whom he wants to have mercy, and he hardens whom he wants to harden. One of you will say to me then, then why does God still blame us? Who is able to resist his will? Okay, is this not something you guys would have been writing 20 minutes ago, listening to this conversation? Why does God still blame us? For who is able to resist his will? But who are you, a human being, to talk back to God? Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, why did you make me like this? Does not the potter have the right to make out of the same lump of clay some pottery for special purposes and some for common use? What if God, although choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath, prepared for destruction? What if he did this to make the riches of his glory known to the objects of his mercy, whom he prepared in advance for glory, even us whom he called, not only from the Jews, but also from the Gentiles? I'm sorry, but it's very hard to read this passage in Romans and not make it sound like God decided a long time before us who's going to be saved and who's going to be damned, and he has a right to choose. And who are we to question that? Is that not what this says? Is there some other interpretation of this? And yet there are those other verses that Arminius would have quoted. Which is why we have to have some humility about this whole thing. Okay? I tend to fall on the Calvinist side, but with humility, knowing that I don't have it all figured out, because there is so much authority and power in passages like this one in Romans 9 and others, that God, before the beginning of time, predestined us. Those he predestined, he called. Those he called, he justified. Those he justified, he glorified. It would be much easier if it didn't say that, but it does, and not just once or twice. You saw, and there are others too. I didn't use them all. So what do we do with that?
So how do we pray for somebody to be saved? Or?
Well, we still pray for somebody to be saved. Let me tell you, and I'm going to give you something here from Calvin. This is, I'm not quoting Calvin exactly here, but this is the difference between Calvin and the really harsh hyper-Calvinists who were so absolutely sure, you know, who actually, the hyper-Calvinists, when they were controlling the Presbyterian faith in Scotland, they would do the fencing of the table. You ever heard of that? Where the strong men in the Presbyterian, the Reformed congregations, when it came time for communion, they would stand at the front of the church, and anybody that was not believed to be one of the elect, based upon how they lived their life or for whatever reason, they would physically prevent from coming forward to take communion. I don't think that's where Calvin was coming from. That was called the fencing of the table. Now they use, when we talk about fencing the table, that term is sometimes still used when we talk about, and I should do this more, by the way, when we have communion, about the fact Scripture says there, you know, that those who eat and drink unworthily eat and drink judgment on themselves. The idea that we should be cautious about this and take it seriously. Okay, but in Calvin's view, Calvin acknowledged, I'm reading here, because this is, I want to make sure you get the words I'm saying. Calvin acknowledged the Bible as teaching that some are elected or predestined, but he insisted that we could only be sure of our own salvation. This is the part where Calvin had some humility, and it's not the hyper-Calvinism. We could only be sure of our own salvation, and so could never judge whether or not another person was be saved. The idea, the doctrine of predestination, is not to say, okay, you're saved. The rest of you, you know. The point of predestination is to remind us that God is free and that He is gracious. There is nothing we can do to earn God's favor. Our salvation comes from God alone. The focus here is the sovereignty of God. God is God. He will do what He will, and it is not for us to question Him about that, or at least not to the point where we say, well, if you don't do it the way I want, I'm out of here. Because God will say, okay. You know? We're not peers. We are not equals with God to challenge Him on this stuff. That's what the whole book of Job is about, by the way. It's the same thing that we just read in Romans 9. Properly understood, the doctrine of predestination is to be held in harmony with the doctrine of God's love for all humankind and His desire that all should be saved, which Scripture says. We don't know how those two things fit together. But we can't just say, I don't like that predestination stuff, and blow off all of those passages which seem to be very clear about that, not without doing violence to God's Word. The doctrine of predestination then frees us from the speculation of who is saved and who is not, leaving us relying wholly on God's divine wisdom and grace. For me, it comes down to one simple thing. If I'm going to err on one side or the other, I will err on the side that God is both all-sovereign and all-loving, rather than err on the side of saying people can make up their own minds about stuff. If I'm going to err, I'm going to err on the side of the God. Okay? One more thing, and then I'm going to quote the second Helvetic Confession, which is a Swiss confession. Helvetia was Switzerland. The second Helvetic Confession says, for the preaching of Christ is to be heard, and it is to be believed, and it is to be held as beyond doubt that if you believe and are in Christ, you are elected. Rather than us try to parse who is and who isn't, if somebody professes to us that I believe in Jesus Christ, if they say with their mouth that Jesus is Lord and they believe in their heart that God has raised Him from the dead, then we accept them as a brother and sister in the Lord. This should not be a dividing thing for the church. But we also can't just throw away the verses that seem to indicate that God is acting in preordaining salvation. Becky?
Well, since there's verses for both sides, why couldn't it be some of both? Some of us are preordained, but still all is worthy of salvation.
Well, none are worthy of salvation.
Well, I mean, all
only Christ.
Can be saved.
Only Christ. Well, yeah, but again, the question is, where do you draw those lines? You know, that's the problem, is people are always trying to draw lines. I'm prepared to say that when I read the passages about predestination, that God has chosen some for salvation, and it's not that I don't believe that the natural logical result is that if He chooses some for salvation, the ones He didn't choose are left for damnation or chosen for damnation. But if I believe that and I focus on that, that doesn't mean that I have to then throw away any idea of the love and grace and mercy of God and his desire for all people. I simply have to say, I don't know how that works out together. Most people say, I have to pick one and throw all the rest away. Well, that means throwing away scripture verses that seem to be very clear about that. I'm prepared to say, again, if I'm going to err, I'll err on the side of the sovereignty and mercy and grace of God. But still recognize that scripture says that God does not desire that any would be condemned, but that all would be saved. That's why I preach salvation. You know, that's why I believe in evangelism. That's why I believe in missions. I don't know how all that works out. But for heaven's sake, I don't want to stand before the Lord at the end and say, well, I decided it was all up to you anyway, so I sat on my fat butt for 20 years of my life and didn't do anything to introduce other people to you, because I don't think that's going to be the answer he wants to hear. Okay? But I have to hold these things in tension. Most people, because they don't like what predestination sounds like, are quick to want to throw that away. I don't think, John Calvin, the reason I give him credit is that he read these passages like Romans 9, and he said, how can we not deal with that? And he tried to deal with that, but he tried to deal with it humbly. The people who came after him, you know, and that's what this says, is that don't focus on who's not saved. Focus on the fact that if you believe in Jesus Christ and God has filled your heart by his Spirit, that you are one of the elect, and give thanks for that. That's the focus. Now, don't ever, if somebody says they're saved, it's not for you to say they're not. Okay, but he was honest with it, and he struggled with it, and he presented what he thought was a sound theology. So many people, their theology is based on the fact that I don't like that. I don't like where that takes me. I'm not comfortable with that. That doesn't feel good, so therefore I'm not going to buy it. Don't let that be what makes your decision. Okay, Becky first, and then you run.
I mean, this is such a great conversation. I mean, this is really, really good. The thief that died on the cross, I mean, would he be still a predestined person, or would he have been just God's grace was sufficient?
Well, based upon Calvinism, and based upon, well, it's still that God's grace is sufficient. I mean, again, we can't, all of us by God's grace. Like I say, we all start out damned, and whoever gets saved is by God's grace. It's just what's the difference? Yes, the Calvinist doctrine, Reformed doctrine, would say that the thief on the cross was one of the elect from the very start. It's just he didn't claim that gift that was offered to him until right then, but that he would have. That's, you know, and there's a lot of jokes about, you know, predestination and Calvinism. You know, our friends, the Catholics, I was talking about earlier, Dale Alquist, he told me the joke about the Calvinist who fell down the stairs, you know, bang, 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 all the way to the spot on the stairs, and he got up and went, boy, I'm glad that's over. The suggestion being it was going to happen. Just glad it got over with. Okay. So yeah, you can make all sorts of cracks about it. Ron?
My question is, how can God say that he wants all to be saved, and yet he predestined some to be there?
That is the question. You articulated it well. But you see the verses that we have right here. And again, most people read these verses or those verses, and they pick one or the other, and they completely discount the other side. There are two sides, both of which seem to be very much substantiated in Scripture. And this is why God's smarter than us. We have to have humility about it.
Is there some way, unlike Democrats and Republicans, that these two theories can be reconciled?
Well, there's never been a way to reconcile it yet. Not effectively. There have been other ideas toward it, but in fact, let me give you a couple ideas. Let me talk a little bit more about some of the things. Let me talk for a minute about Luther and what Luther called single predestination. Luther believed that the elect are predestined to salvation, but he wouldn't take the next step and say that those who are not elected to predestination are elected to damnation. And again, Calvin and others would have argued that Marty, you know, there's a logical conclusion that you have to come to there. If God picked these and he didn't pick these, then what do you deal with that, you know? But Luther taught that eternal damnation is the result of unbeliever's sins, that rejection of the forgiveness of sins and unbelief were the cause of damnation, not that God had selected you not to be saved, okay? But again, there's that, and it's called the paradox of free will. The idea, it starts with the idea that if God foreknew, that he could see who was going to do what, and he didn't do anything about it, then we don't really have free will. You can't claim, well, I have free will because God knew what I was going to choose, but he didn't make me. He knew what you could do, what you were going to choose, and he completely has the power to affect that, and he didn't, then duh, you know. And so, again, that's a philosophical argument there's really not any answer to, and that was one Luther didn't deal with, he didn't struggle with. But Luther did talk about the free will. He wrote, Erasmus was a philosopher who wrote a book called On Free Will. And Luther responded to that with a book called The Bondage of the Will, in which it was a debate that he had with Erasmus over the issue of free will. And the whole focus was single predestination, that God elects some to salvation, but he would not go to the point of saying that he elects some to damnation. And so it's kind of a halfway in between, but it's open-ended to the point that it's philosophically unsatisfying. Okay? There's simply questions that Luther didn't deal with. So that's one attempt, is to go halfway. Another approach is a thing called open theism. Open theism is basically it's a belief in predestination, but it's a belief in corporate predestination. Meaning that God predestined all who would be part of the church to salvation, and we get to decide whether we're part of the church. You see the difference? He didn't predestine that Ross will be saved, as opposed to not being saved. He predestined that all members of the church would be saved, and then I get to decide whether I'm part of that. Okay. But again, that breaks down because most of the passages we looked at are talking to individuals and individual choice. It doesn't really seem that the scriptures directly apply to that. And then another option, which has been expounded, is the idea of universalism. Christian universalists, and you know that universalism was a movement, Unitarianism was a movement. Unitarianism believes that there's no Trinity, that there's only one God, that there's not a God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, there's only one God. Well, the Unitarians and the Universalists, back 100 years ago or something, it's a long time ago, neither one of them could really sustain themselves. But they decided they were close enough in what they taught that they got together and formed the Unitarian Universalists. And so that's why you have Unitarian Universalists. There's a Unitarian Universalist meeting here. I don't think they call themselves churches, I don't think. But it's a meeting that here. Well, the Universalists, Christian Universalists, that they would call themselves, which is just, they agree that both Calvinists and Arminians. Now, there are Universalists that aren't Unitarian Universalists. I need to be clear about that. So Universalists who would say that they're Christian, they agree with both the Calvinists and the Arminians that everyone is born in sin, everyone suffers total depravity, everyone is in need of salvation. The difference is, they believe that a person, while you're saved in Jesus Christ, that salvation will come to everyone. And so they resolve the problem by saying, everybody gets to be elect. Everybody gets a car, everybody gets a car. Okay? You guys know what that is, right? That's Oprah.
Yeah.
So the passages about, but again, what about the passages about those who are condemned? They just blow all that off. I don't think they can do that. I've told you what I think. I have not given you a firm answer because there isn't a firm answer if you're honest about it. Now, if you go to a reform school, reform theology school, and you study this stuff, they would give you the predestination Calvinist view and not the other. Unless it was to say, well, let me tell you for 2 minutes what these stupid people say. If you went to an Arminian school, or church even, and they would teach you Arminianism, and they'd say, well, these awful Calvinists, let me tell you what they said in 2 minutes. Okay, I don't think we can do that. We are not that smart. We are not that wise. We have to try to recognize that Scripture could be used to argue either one of these sides and hold them in balance. As I say, if I have to err, I will err on the side of the sovereignty of God rather than the will of people. And yet, I believe the passages that say that God does not desire that any would be condemned, but all would come to a saving knowledge. I believe that's why we preach. I believe that's why we have missions and evangelize. We cannot set that aside. But I confess in humility that I don't know how those two things fit together.
The dogma of the Presbyterian Church chooses which?
Calvinists. Okay. The Presbyterian Church is based upon Reformed theology written by John Calvin, and so it is Calvinist. Now again, Calvinism changed from Calvin himself, I believe, to hyper-Calvinist, and now has taken a much more modest kind of approach to it, which confesses that we don't have all the answers. And that our job isn't to stand up and start, you know, you following people line up on the wall here because you're going to hell, you know, kind of stuff. Which is almost what they did at one point in the radical hyper-Calvinist kind of days. So have some humility, but understand what the issues are. Yes.
Can I share a bit from Job and then tell you what
sure.
I think? When Satan tested Job and went all through that and his comforters couldn't comfort him and so on, and then finally he's ready to have some answers to questions, and God says, you don't know, and
yeah.
you're trying to judge me and you're suggesting the truth, you don't know all of these things. I don't ever read anywhere where God said, you know, this was all a test.
Yeah.
And I knew that you wouldn't fail, and I knew your friends were going to really be part of the test, and at the end I asked you to pray for them, and you did, and I restored you, and I restored them. I think that's a picture of an all-knowing, almighty, all-powerful God showing that Satan didn't have power, but not to Job, and Job, a loving man who's turned away from evil and loved God, and didn't know from day to day what was going to come next.
Right.
Just, and so we're trying here to mix the omnipotent, all-powerful, all-knowing God with the human, unknowing, dumb sheep.
Right.
And so on the one side with Calvin, God knows from the beginning to the end, he's predestined, he's done this, he's done that. And then some of that scripture gets overmixed with us and we get confused. We say, oh, how can that be? How could it not be? On the other side, we have to pray for one another and love one another
right.
and trust God. And then he intervenes, and he almost makes it seem like, well, since you did this, I've changed my mind. But what he's saying is, I've used your love and your effectual prayer or whatever
right.
so that you see a bit of what's happening. And especially with people like Paul, he knows he's going to go to Rome. He knows the ship's going to be wrecked. Special knowledge from God.
Yep.
And God will say in many different places, well, I sent you to Nineveh because I know that they will repent. And he'll
right.
say to Jerusalem, if this had happened there, they would have repented. And you guys have hardened your heart. But God knew they would.
Yep.
He's not surprised. And so we want to not work out our salvation in fear and trembling, but that's the only thing we can do because we're dumb blind sheep.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants to us to show forth what's inside of each one of us, and he will do it in his way.
Yep.
And we don't know, so some of us are going to just curse God and die, and others are going to try to follow.
Exactly. Well, and I think you're exactly right. In the book of Job, which is a fairly long book, all the way through it, Job's question is saying, God, why? You know, why is this? He doesn't curse God. As his wife tells him, curse God and die. He doesn't reject God, but he still says, I don't understand. Help me understand. And the answer is, are you God? Were you there when I stretched the ark of the heavens? Were you there? And he goes in this long litany of, really, Job? Are you one to question me about this stuff? And the point is that Job has faith. You know, he's got sort of kind of unsure faith for a long time, but still he has faith. And at the end, he is confirmed in his faith, and he even prays for the salvation, you know, for the preservation of his friends. But what I've said several times now, I think we have to have humility about this. But what is humility when we're talking about issues like this but faith? But saying, I trust that God knows what he's doing, even if I don't. He is God and I am not. And there's a point beyond which I can't go. I've studied this stuff a lot. You know, I've looked at this stuff a lot. I don't have any answers. People a lot smarter than me who have studied it a lot longer than I have don't really have answers. Every once in a while, somebody has sufficient human pride that they claim they have an answer, and usually it's because they're rejecting somebody else's idea. I think we have to have faith that God knows what he's doing, and that involves having humility about, we need to know it. We need to know what Scripture says. We need to know what the ideas are in order for us to have an understanding of salvation. But believe that God is in charge, sovereignty, but God is also loving and merciful. And that's why we evangelize. Okay, we have to hold those things in tension, and that's what humble faith is. Okay, Mary, first.
I read somewhere that Luther, after he stopped trying to earn his way into heaven, he was still trying to figure out what's going on.
Right.
And he finally came to a point where he said, well, Lord, if you want to send me to hell, that's sort of up to you. I'm okay with that now.
Yeah. Exactly. Luther was a very